Spirit. Please be seated. So before I left, we'd been following the story of David, his rise from a young boy to becoming king, and then his fall and punishment. But God was faithful to his promise. And now the line of David through Solomon has been restored. And one of the things that Solomon went about doing is what David first wanted to do, and that is to get a home for God. God had traveled with him in the wilderness in the tabernacle, and David had long thought, once he got all of that mansion to himself, that that God needed something at least a little bit nicer than the tabernacle that had been kind of resting outside. So God, in God's wisdom, said, David, you're not the person to do this. This would be about David if it came about. But Solomon built God's home, and now we have this wonderful place where God dwells, where God is incredibly present, so much so that there is a cloud that just overwhelms people with a sense of God's presence and God's holiness. And now, no matter where people are in the world, whether they're fighting battles or whether they're well away from Jerusalem, there is a place that they can point to and know that their prayers will be heard. There is a constant where God resides. And that is huge. And this is the beginning of an incredible movement where people understand that they can make pilgrimage to the temple to honor God, where they can kind of bend their life around a place where God is incredibly present. So we have that fulfillment of a story, and it happens to collide with the journey that we've been taking with the gospel. Because at the same time as we've been building towards this temple culture, towards this place where God is incredibly present, Jesus is somewhat tearing that down and saying that you don't need a temple. You are God's temple. God can reside in you. So we have these things coming at each other. And that's helpful to know when we get a little bit of what people's response was to Jesus' comments. Now, Jesus, before I left, was getting ready to go across the way. And as he is in his boat, people see him and they get to the other side so fast that they are assembled before he even gets out of the boat. And he has pity on them because they have no food. And he feeds them with fishes and loaves, and the numbers continue to escalate. So when he gets back to the other side, there's even more people gathered around to see what this is that's taking place. Who is this person that can feed people in such amazing ways, that can do these works of God, that can do miracles? And his stock is soaring. And then faster than Howard Dean's plummet after he screams into the camera, Jesus' popularity goes in the opposite direction. Why? One, why did Jesus, the Word, with that infinite wisdom to always have the right word for the right time, allow it to happen? And two, why does it happen? So Jesus is at the other side and he realizes that people are gathered around because they see something powerful. They see the soup du jour, the person of the day, there's nothing going on, and they all gather around to see what miracle Jesus is going to do next, what powerful thing he can do, and he realizes that's not what he came to the world to do. That's not going to transform the world. That's not going to reveal God for generations to come. So he starts to say some hard truths, and I think he's actually somewhat combative about it. He takes what people understand to be true, and he rocks it. He flips it over. There's one thing that people understood, it was dietary laws, that God wanted us to be very careful about what we consume, about what we let into our bodies, and that we're reminded by God every time we make one of those dietary decisions. And at the very top of that list was do not consume blood. Blood was holy. You don't drink blood. In fact, blood was offered up at the altar, and there's to show you exactly how much God told them about it. You go to Leviticus, and this is what God has to say about drinking blood. If anyone of the house of Israel or of the aliens who reside among them eats any blood, I will set my face against that person who eats blood. and will cut that person off from the people. For the life of the flesh is the blood, and I have given it to you for making atonement for your lives on the altar. For as life, it is the blood that makes atonement. Therefore I have said to the people of Israel, no person among you shall eat blood, nor shall any alien who resides among you eat blood. And if any one of the people of Israel or of the aliens who reside among them who hunts down an animal or bird that may be eaten shall pour out its blood and cover it with earth. For the life of every creature, its blood is its life. Therefore I have said to the people of Israel, you shall not eat the blood of any creature. For the life of every creature is its blood, and whoever eats it shall be cut off. So I mentioned a few weeks ago that Jesus sort of throws everybody for a loop at this feeding of the 5,000 because people are what they eat and who they eat with. And the whole idea of taking food that you don't know where it came from, of eating with strangers, it threw everything upside down, and it was incredibly anxious for those that were participating. And now he goes even a step further. And he points to the atoning sacrifice that he will be for the world, but he encourages them to eat his blood and his flesh. Imagine what people are saying and shaking their head and thinking. And then he says that God will dwell in you. This temple culture where you knew where God was in a nice, safe, contained place over across town. Now he's saying God will be with you. I think Jesus knew what he was doing. I think Jesus knew that in order for people to understand the heart of God, they were going to have to hear some hard truths. And it wasn't about his popularity. It wasn't about the numbers of people that were following him. It was about the heart of God. And he understood that people needed to realize this was not going to be easy. And this was going to be revolutionary to the way they thought about God in the past. God was going to spill God's self out as an atoning sacrifice for the world. But this wasn't about power and might and miracle. It was about service. So what do we understand when we participate in that feast? What do we understand when we break bread, when we drink the blood? And sometimes I do think that the words don't quite hit us the way they might have if we'd never been in the church before. The words of the Eucharist, take this, my body, which is given for you, drink this, my blood. It is provocative. That's why it has power in our lives. And when I think about the Eucharist, I was talking to our teachers as we're getting ready for a new school year, and I talked about why it is the central thing that we do as a community here during the week and on Sunday. And I talked about a place where there is no words. Bishop Curry, now the presiding bishop-elect, when talking about the Eucharist, says that in his pastoral life, there have been places that he couldn't go. And I, in the course of the last week, have experienced that. There are no words to someone who's lost a spouse or a mother. There's no words for someone who's been put out of their house, who suffers from addiction, who's a victim of domestic abuse. There's just not words that make it go away. But there is the presence of God, and there is that reception of Christ's love and Christ's grace and Christ's goodness into your lives. And where I can't go, where I don't have words, I can invite God. And in that, something can take place. That's what Bishop Curry says. He also says it crosses over divides. He talks about when he was, before he was ever born, his dad being a Baptist preacher going into an Episcopal church and watching this strange phenomena take place as people were coming up to the table. And to his surprise, in this all-white church, he watches as his future wife walks up to the altar, puts her hands out, and receives that gift of Christ's body, and then drinks of Christ's blood right beside a white person on right and on her left. And he realizes in the moment that's the first time in his entire life he's ever seen a white person and a black person drink from the same cup. And he said, if this meal can overcome that kind of estrangement, that kind of division, this was something he wanted to participate in. And generation later, he became the bishop of our church, of our whole church. But it's not just all of those graces that take place in the Eucharist, it's also the cost. And that's the other thing that Jesus wants us to know about. It's what we hear in Ephesians is our Christian responsibility as partakers in that feast. That we take that feast and we realize the cost of which it was given to us. And we walk out and we realize that we're called to serve in the same sacrificial way. I was reminded of Oscar Romero, who was elected bishop of El Salvador, and they thought he would be kind of a do-nothing bishop. They kind of had the same sort of thoughts that they originally had about Pope Francis, that he hadn't done anything all that controversial in his time beforehand. But soon after he was elected bishop, a dear friend of his, who had been preaching vociferously for the poor and against the revolution that was taking place and against both sides that were fighting against one another, and just been a phenomenal advocate for the voiceless. And he watched as he was shot down, and he realized that his mission, what he received at the Eucharist, had to be spilled out. And he became a voice for the voiceless. He had a radio show that was the most popular radio hour in El Salvador. And every week he would take that hour to talk about injustice, to talk about the poor that went hungry, to talk about both sides of the revolution, that we have one church. We don't have a rich church and a poor church. We have one church, and that all of us are called to put down our arms and to care for one another. And his message was so provocative that it led to his own death. And after he preached a sermon with that very same message, he walked behind the table, and as he was ready to pick up the bread, somebody drove by, shot down the open door along the aisle, and struck him dead. And they say as they saw the splattered blood on the spilled wafers, that the church had an icon of what it is to participate in the holy life, the life of God. The life that was spilled out for all of us. So the Eucharist isn't easy. Jesus saw that in the feeding of the 5,000, that people were so enamored by the might that they forgot the cost. He wanted those that followed to understand that this had cost. This has grace and this has love, but it's also to be spilled out for others. So I invite you forward to receive what you need, to be filled to overflowing, but to also realize that you are to walk out and spill your life for the needs of the world. Amen.